There are many moons in the solar system, but none like ours. It exerts an extraordinary influence on planet Earth, keeping our world in balance. But why is it so powerful?
I want to explore the relationship we have with our closest neighbour, to see how the moon has sculpted our planet and shaped our evolution. Without the moon, would we even be here?
I'm Maggie Adairin-Pocock. I'm a space scientist and a lunar fanatic. I've always been mad about the moon, convinced it plays a huge role in our lives. But I've always taken for granted that it is where it is in the night sky, a quarter of a million miles away. In this film, I'm taking nothing for granted. I'm going to find out what would happen if the moon wasn't where it is now.
What if the moon was in a different position? Closer or further away? How different would our world be?
The moon is a ball of rock out in space, but it has the power to create great tides here on Earth. This is Loch Etive on the west coast of Scotland. Twice a day, the moon drags 66 million tons of seawater through this loch. The result? White water rapids. The head of the lock is like a bottleneck. Water is funneled through a very narrow channel. And for an hour or two, this becomes one of the wildest, wettest rides in the world.
These are the Falls of Laura. That's what the locals call them. In Gaelic, Laura means noisy. Because as the tidal waters rush out of the lock, it gets very, very loud. Kayakers come from all across the world to take the challenge of these waters. But they have to paddle like mad just to keep up. Even our outboard engine is struggling with the flow. This is what the power of the moon looks like, up close.
My love affair with the moon began as a child.
I wish I was a spaceman, the fastest guy alive.
I was born in 1968, in the age of Apollo. I took my first steps as Neil Armstrong took his giant leap. Of course, I was too young to know what was going on, but the images became seared in my mind. From an early age, I wanted to go to the moon. At school, I struggled because I'm dyslexic. But then I discovered science and something clicked. I wanted to become a scientist. And sure enough, today I build satellites. It's a mix of engineering and physics, and I love it. But now that I'm a space scientist, hardly anyone is talking about the moon anymore. It used to be the new frontier, our future. Now it's seen as quaint, old-fashioned, irrelevant. I think that's wrong. Completely wrong.
I'm still mad about the moon. Not just because I want to be an astronaut and go there one day. No. I'm mad about the moon because the more I find out about it, the more extraordinary it seems.
The way it can conjure up this torrent of water by simply passing overhead. And how does it do this? With the help of gravity. Gravity is a great universal force of attraction. It keeps us firmly in our place on Earth and keeps the moon in orbit around us. But while the Earth is attracting the moon is also attracting the Earth, pulling at our oceans.
So I have a set of scales, a metal block, and a powerful little magnet. You see, the force of gravity is very similar to magnetism. They're both forces of attraction. If I put the metal block on the scales, you can see it weighs 1.3 kilograms. When I pull the magnet in and nudge it closer, the block appears to weigh less. You can see the needle moving. That's because the magnet is attracting the metal towards it, pulling it upwards off the scales. And that's what the moon's doing. It's pulling on the oceans, moving them upwards, away from the surface of the Earth.
The gravitational force of the moon creates a bulge of water in the oceans. And as the moon orbits the Earth, it drags this bulge around the planet, producing high and low tides. The size of the tides depends on the distance between the Earth and the Moon.
The laws of physics are very clear about this. The closer two things are, the more they attract each other, the greater the gravitational force. So we get the tides we do because the Moon is where it is, nearly a quarter of a million miles away. But what if the Moon were closer?
If the moon were just a little closer than it is today, the tidal bulge would grow. Low tides would be lower, high tides would be higher, and any low-lying coastline would be flooded.
But what if the moon were much closer? 5 times, 10 times, 20 times closer than it is today? How would that affect the tides and life here on Earth?
Another rush hour in London. But this evening, as the sun sets, a huge moon rises. 20 times closer than normal. This super-sized moon exerts a super-sized gravitational force, 400 times stronger than we're used to. And it creates a mighty tidal bulge. Seawater pours across the British Isles. London is flooded. Hours later, the same tidal bulge hits the east coast of America. And the story is the same. It's New York's turn to disappear underwater. A city submerged. And all the work of the moon. Eventually, of course, the moon moves on. The tide subsides. The waters retreat.
This scenario may seem rather far-fetched, like the plot of some disaster movie. But something similar has happened. Once upon a time, when the moon was newly formed, it really was so close, and really was so powerful.
Let me take you back to the earliest days of our planet. 4.5 billion years ago. At this time, the Earth had no moon. It was orbiting the sun alone. And it was being assaulted by rocks and comets. Today, there are no scars left from this cosmic pinball. But to get a sense of the damage that was done, I've come to the Arizona desert, to a great hole in the ground.
This is a beautiful crater. A near-perfect circle, a mile in diameter. It was formed when a meteor crashed into the Earth a mere 50,000 years ago. That's nothing on the timescale that we're talking about. But it's amazing how much damage that one passing rock can cause. The early Earth was bombarded with rocks. It must have been mayhem. And then along came something much, much bigger.
Another planet, the size of Mars, drifted into the path of Earth. It was on a collision course.
It hit the young Earth with a glancing blow. Imagine the power released by such a collision.
The impact sent a mass of liquid rock into orbit. This debris coalesced into a ball. And the moon was formed. Just 14,000 miles away from the early Earth. This was the closest point it could have been. Any closer, and gravity would have pulled the debris crashing back to Earth, and there'd be no moon.
Today, the moon is just a rock, reflecting the sun's light. But back then, it was a molten sphere burning brightly. It must have looked amazing. An enormous orange disc in the sky.
Imagine the scene. The first moonrise over the early Earth. Our world was no longer alone. It had a huge, powerful neighbor. And ever since, this has been a very different type of planet. The collision that created the moon reset the basic chemistry of Earth. And Earth, Mark II, was a place on which life could begin. The collision released huge quantities of metal from the Earth's core. One particular metal that would help change the atmosphere of our planet. I'm talking about iron.
Iron is incredibly reactive. Leave some out in the garden and it will rust. It also combines with other chemicals to release gases such as methane, carbon monoxide and hydrogen. Today, we see these gases as toxic and rather unpleasant. But in the early Earth, this was the very stuff of life.
In the 1950s, American chemist Stanley Miller did a classic experiment. He took a cocktail of these gases and tried to simulate conditions on the early Earth, adding electricity to mimic the power of lightning. And what emerged, to everyone's surprise, was a flask of slime, which turned out to be full of amino acids.
Like iron, amino acids are essential for life. They are the raw material from which proteins are made. And this great chemist was able to produce them using gases that were available on the early Earth.